BBC Audio presents The Curious Cases of Rutherford and Fry, Series 1 to 10.
Today's study is close to my own heart, dear listener.
And more importantly, your head.
Quite. And I do hope dear to you as well, Adam, because as a geneticist, the curious case of the scarlet mark is one with DNA at its core.
Indeed, we have pledged to investigate your everyday questions using the power of science. And recently, we received the following correspondence from a Dr. Sheena Cruikshank in Manchester.
My eldest son is ginger, but I am blonde, and my husband brunette. So we are constantly asked where the red came from. Further, people do say the ginger gene is dying out, but with the apparent ability to skip generations, as in our case, how good is that maths, or is it just anecdotal?
Yes, well, we'll come to the ginger gene in good time, and to the question of the extinction of your kind. But, Hannah, it must be noted that you do bear the scarlet mark like a fiery beacon.
Yes. Thanks. I think I am what is commonly referred to as a massive ginger.
Yes. Would you like to share some of your experiences with us?
Yes, I would, actually, my swampy friend. Often you wander around forgetting how you look to the outside world, but then every now and then someone will come and remind you that you're different. Take, for instance, this example. It was a perfectly normal day. The sun was shining. I was walking down the road, minding my own business. Just moved to London, was full of the joys of spring, when across the road from me, a young man coming towards me shouted out,
"Oi, Ginger Minga!"
Yes, that's appalling. Does this happen often?
Well, probably not so much now that I'm a bit older, but I reckon about once a week when I was in my early 20s.
Well, it is appalling and deplorable, but where does this prejudice come from? Now, to solve this case, we need some evidence. So I turned to redheaded cultural historian Professor Kate Williams from the University of Reading.
Through history, redheads have stood out and they've been mistrusted. Shakespeare calls it the dissembling colour. So redheads are often seen as liars, like Judas who sold Christ down the river. So they're not a safe person for a friend.
And Judas, is he a redhead in the Bible?
Judas isn't a redhead in the Bible, but he's constantly represented as redhead. So red hair almost comes to stand for something that's mean, that's cruel, that's also sometimes slightly witchcrafty. When you look at the Malleus Maleficarum, the Witchfinder's Handbook, the actual original said, you can't trust women with beautiful hair. So witches are often women with beautiful hair. That's all it said in the original. When it was translated in the early 20th century, the translator, he put in reference to red-haired witches. So redheads are often seen as people you simply shouldn't have around.
And how far does that go back?
We've got records of the ancient Greeks. The Thracians, who they saw as a lesser state, they would be characterised as red-haired and discriminated against. So it goes back right as far as we can see about people talking about representations, is that red hair is something that's hated, it's something that's mistrusted. And I think the only really reason we can think of for that is that it is the colour of blood.
But really, is life that bad for you?
Well, I certainly wouldn't suggest it was anything like suffering from racism. But there's other examples of Cryos, for instance, one of the world's biggest sperm banks, that banned ginger donations a few years ago because they said it was unfashionable. I think there was a lack of demand, to be fair. But there was a big outcry about this. And they have now allowed ginger men to donate their sperm once again. But it has to be said, it's a lot cheaper to buy.
I am sorry for your troubles, but we must get back to the case in hand. Dr. Cruikshank wishes to understand her son's condition, shall we call it?
I prefer to think of us as more biologically unique. So what is it that makes us different? Well, the story begins with what you could safely class as a pretty niche hobby that sprang up at the end of the 19th century.
People started to collect mice with different coat colours. It was referred to as the mouse fancy. And originally this was very big in China and Asia.
This is Jonathan Rees. He's a dermatologist from the University of Edinburgh. And he's one of the scientists who discovered the ginger gene. Yes, I know dermatologists study skin. We'll come to that bit later. But first, back to those fancy mice with their coats of many colours.
Through the sort of 20th century, people began to be interested in why those mice had different coat colours. And in the early 1990s, a group in America, Roger Cohn and colleagues, identified a gene that seemed to be important in determining whether mice had a yellow coat colour or whether they had a black coat colour. And for reasons we still don't fully understand, yellow in mice is probably the same thing as red in humans. So that gave us a clue.
So they set out to investigate this gene in humans. Could a simple change in the code be responsible for some people inheriting their gloriously fiery locks? But Jonathan's experiment didn't turn out quite as they'd expected.
The experiment was collect a bunch of 20 to 30 people with bright red hair, collect a bunch of 20 to 30 people with dark hair, sequence the gene in both groups. And in one sense, what we were expecting to find was that there would be a single change, and that would be sort of easy, and it's a nice, simple story.
The problem was they didn't find just one change. They found so many different variations in the code, they thought their machinery had broken.
Yes, well, genetics is rarely simple, but this, in a nutshell, is how it works. We all have a gene called MC1R. What Jonathan Rees and his colleagues discovered was that redheads have one of a handful of different types of this gene, almost like flavours. In our bodies, MC1R is involved in pigmentation, how we are coloured, and it all works via a molecule called melanin.
So we have two types of melanin. We have a sort of brown melanin and we have a sort of red or yellow melanin. This gene codes for a receptor, a protein, it's almost like a little volume control, that alters the ratio of the two melanins. So if you have bright red hair, you tend to produce more of the red melanin, whereas if you have very dark hair, you tend to produce the brown or black melanin.
So by turning the volume control up and down to change the ratio of brown and red melanin, this produces all of the glorious shades of red hair that we see, from rich auburn to strawberry blondes.
Elementary, Dr. Rutherford. But hang on, that doesn't answer Sheena's question, because she's a blonde and her husband is a brunette. So how come they had a ginger baby?
Well, we all have two copies of each gene, one from our mother and one from our father. And the red version of the MC1R gene is recessive, meaning that you need two copies to be a redhead. If you only have one, you are merely a carrier. So by deduction, my dear Dr. Fry, Sheena and her husband must both be carriers, and each one of them has passed down their one ginger copy, meaning their son has inherited two, and thus he is a redhead.
But Sheena's son, I think you should embrace your red hair, because there have been other times in history when red hair has been glorious. Take Queen Elizabeth I, for example. After the ginger King Henry VIII had his marriage to Anne Boleyn annulled, and just before he had her head chopped off, their daughter Elizabeth was branded illegitimate. But she used her flame-coloured hair as a secret weapon when she took the throne.
Elizabeth I made every effort to seem as ginger as possible, because what she was doing was saying, I am just like my father, Henry VIII, as opposed to her dark, swarthy mother, Anne Boleyn. It was Henry VIII she was evoking, saying, I am the rightful Tudor. So she made her face very white with lead paint, and she wore these incredible bright red wigs. And she really inspired her courtiers to go red too. So you have men using rhubarb juice and sulfuric acid to make their beards red, or to please the queen. So there is this fantastic time in which red hair is wonderful in the flowering of the Tudor period. I think perhaps the greatest time for gingers in history.
That brings us nicely onto the subject of skin, because red hair is often accompanied by what I like to call ginger skin.
Pale and interesting, I think, is what we refer to it as.
Oh, I'd say translucent with a hint of blue.
Yes. Well, look, interestingly, the same melanin that produces the red colour in your hair also pigments your skin. And if you don't have this type of melanin, then your skin is simply not as good at filtering out ultraviolet light, which means that you are, I presume, prone to sunburn.
Hey, I can wear factor 50 and be sat in the shade and still get burnt from the reflection of the sun off the sand.
I'm sorry, I shouldn't laugh.
But it's not all bad news for ginger skin. I asked dermatologist Jonathan Rees whether there are any advantages to my pale tones.
Yeah, we think so, because if you sort of run the evolutionary clock back, say 30,000 years ago, probably most people had dark skin and much of humanity lived in Africa. As humans moved out of Africa, there seemed to be some advantage in having paler skin. So this was actually selected for, and we think the reason for that is that you do need some degree of ultraviolet radiation to synthesize vitamin D in your skin.
Yes, I'll definitely give you that. It's the pale skin that's the advantage, not necessarily the red hair. But as Sheena pointed out earlier, She mentioned that it wasn't that long ago that newspapers were full of headlines spelling doom for the redhead.
Gingers face extinction due to climate change, scientists warn.
Redheads could become extinct.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.